Hello and a very warm welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching the news tonight with me, Frank Rausen Pereira. Let's begin with the headlines. At an interaction on COVID management with 10 Indian neighborhood nations, Prime Minister Modi suggests 5 measures to combat pandemic, urges special visa for health workers and an agreement on air ambulances. Centre stress on more private sector participation in energy sector. Prime Minister Modi chairs high-level meeting, underscores need for policies that safeguard interests of both consumers and producers. Prime Minister Modi launches Mahabahu Brahmaputra Waterways project, asserts development of Northeast and increase in connectivity are priorities for the government. Home Minister Amit Shah flags fifth phase of BJP's Parivartan Yatra in Namkhana, West Bengal, reiterates pledge to usher in Sonar Bangla, accuses Trinamool government with not implementing centre's plans. Lieutenant Governor Tamilisai Soundarajan tells V. Narayanasamy government in Puducherry to prove majority on the 22nd of February. Congress and opposition reduced to 14 MLAs each in the Union Territory. Well, our top focus on the bulletin this evening, Prime Minister Narendra Modi said on Thursday that development of Assam is the priority of the centre and the government is continuously working on it. He said this while launching multiple developmental projects in the state. Here are the details.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi launched the Mahabahu Brahmaputra project in Assam through video conferencing on Thursday. He also laid the foundation stone of a four-lane bridge over the Brahmaputra River between Dhubri and Fulbari and performed Bhumi Pujan for construction of Majuli Bridge. Addressing the event virtually, Prime Minister Narendra Modi said that connectivity was a big challenge for Northeast under previous governments, but his government has made a rapid progress in this direction.
Assam ka vikas prathmikta mein bhi hai aur iske liye din raat prayas bhi ho raha hai. Bhai aur behno, bite 5 varshon mein Assam ki multimodal connectivity ko फिर से स्थापित करने के लिए एक के बाद एक कदम उठाए गए हैं. कोशिश ये है कि असम को, नॉर्थ ईस्ट को दूसरे पूर्वी एशियाई देशों के साथ हमारे सांस्कृतिक और व्यापारिक रिश्तों का भी केंद्र बनाया जाए.
Prime Minister Modi called it a historic day not just for Assam but for the entire northeastern region. He said the Dhubri Fulbari bridge would help several northeastern states. He asserted that development of Assam is a priority and government is working day and night to fulfill this.
Brahmaputra par connectivity se jude jitne kaam pehle hone chahiye the utne nahi hue. Is wajah se Assam ke bhitar bhi aur North East ke anya kshetron mein connectivity hamesha ek badi chunauti bani rahi. महाबाहु ब्रह्मपुत्र के आशीर्वाद से अब दिशा में तेजी से काम हो रहा है. बीते वर्षों में केंद्र और असम की डबल इंजन सरकार ने इस पूरे क्षेत्र की भौगोलिक और सांस्कृतिक दोनों प्रकार की दूरियों को कम करने का प्रयास किया है.
Union Road Transport Minister Nitin Gadkari announced that infrastructure projects worth 1 lakh crore rupees will be started in Assam in coming days.
Pradhan Mantri ji ne hame kaha hai ki jo northeast ki area hai jiske upar vishesh roop se infrastructure development mein dhyan nahi diya gaya uske taraf unhone vishesh dhyan dene ka hum sabko aadesh diya hai aur unhi ke aadesh ke anurup aaj tezi se नॉर्थ ईस्ट में आसाम हो, मेघालय हो, त्रिपुरा हो, नागालैंड हो, सभी नॉर्थ ईस्ट में बहुत तेजी से इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर डेवलप हो रहा है.
द महाबाहु ब्रह्मपुत्र प्रोजेक्ट इज एम्ड एट प्रोवाइडिंग सीमलेस कनेक्टिविटी टू द ईस्टर्न पार्ट्स ऑफ इंडिया. इट विल ऑल्सो स्पीड अप डेवलपमेंट एक्टिविटीज फॉर द पीपल लिविंग अराउंड रिवर ब्रह्मपुत्र एंड रिवर बराक. ब्यूरो रिपोर्ट, राज्यसभा टीवी.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi also said that India has become a power surplus country from a power deficit country. Here's more.
Addressing a webinar towards effective implementation of budget provisions in power and renewable energy sector, the Prime Minister said the government's approach for the sector is guided by mantras of reach, reinforce, reform and renewable energy. Elaborating further, the Prime Minister said that for reach, the government is focused on reaching every village and every household. The Prime Minister also touched upon the efforts to improve ease of doing business in the sector.
कैसे बजट घोषणाओं को तेजी से लागू किया जाए, कैसे सरकार और प्राइवेट सेक्टर एक दूसरे पर विश्वास बढ़ाते हुए आगे बढ़े, इस बात के लिए ये संवाद जरूरी था। एनर्जी सेक्टर को लेकर हमारी सरकार की अप्रोच हमेशा से बहुत होलिस्टिक रही है। हमने इस सेक्टर में उपभोक्ता और उद्यमी दोनों के हितों को ध्यान में रखते हुए नीतियां बनाने का और नीतियों में इम्प्रूवमेंट करने का लगातार प्रयास किया है। पावर सेक्टर में हम जिन चार मंत्रों को लेकर चले वो है रीच, रीइन्फोर्स, रिफॉर्म्स और रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी। बीते कुछ सालों में भी हमने 139 गीगावाट कैपेसिटी जोड़ी है। भारत वन नेशन वन ग्रिड वन फ्रीक्वेंसी उसका लक्ष्य भी प्राप्त कर चुका है।
प्राइम मिनिस्टर नरेंद्र मोदी सेड दैट इंडिया इज वर्किंग टुवर्ड्स अ हेल्दी एंड कोविड 19 फ्री नेबरहुड। एड्रेसिंग अ वर्कशॉप ऑन कोविड 19 मैनेजमेंट एक्सपीरियंस गुड प्रैक्टिसेस एंड वे फॉरवर्ड विद नियरली 10 नेबरिंग कंट्रीज वर्चुअली प्राइम मिनिस्टर मोदी सेड ऑल कंट्रीज हैव लर्नड फ्रॉम ईच अदर फ्रॉम बेस्ट प्रैक्टिसेस।
Allow me to make some suggestions for your discussions today. Can we consider creating a special visa scheme for our doctors and nurses so that they can travel quickly within our region during health emergencies on the request of the receiving country? Can our civil aviation ministries coordinate a regional air ambulance agreement for medical contingencies? Can we create a regional platform for collating, compiling and studying data about the effectiveness of COVID-19 vaccines among our population? Can we similarly create a regional network for promoting technology-driven epidemiology for preventing future pandemics? And beyond COVID-19, can we also share our successful public health policies and schemes? From India, our Ayushman Bharat and Jan Arogya schemes may be useful case studies for our friends in the region.
The fourth edition of Prime Minister Narendra Modi's live interaction with students to beat exam stress, Pariksha Pe Charcha, will be held in March this year in a virtual format. The Union Education Minister Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank announced on Thursday.
In a Twitter message, Prime Minister Modi said that the Pariksha Pe Charcha 2021 is fully online and open to students all over the world this time. He urged the students to appear for exams with a smile and without stress. He also said that on popular demand, the Pariksha Pe Charcha 2021 will also include parents and teachers. In a video message, Education Minister Nishank said that the registration process for Pariksha Pe Charcha program has begun and will remain open till 14th of March. The participants will be elected through an online competition which will be organized on MyGov platform. Students can submit their queries to the Prime Minister on the official website. The portal for online creative writing competition will remain open till 14th of March.
Defeat coronavirus. Let us always remember, wear a mask. Wash hands. Follow physical distancing. Together, we'll succeed. Together, we'll win against COVID-19.
Standing at the center of Quwwatul Islam Mosque inside the historic Qutb complex, this iconic iron pillar gives us a glimpse of Delhi's tryst with the kingdom and its supremacy. This iconic pillar bears an inscription written in a later form of Brahmi script of Ashokan time. The inscription on the pillar talks about the victory of a great king, defeating his enemies from the expanse of areas between what is now Bengal to Punjab. The pillar is 7 meters tall and is 1 meter below the ground with diameter of 48 centimeters at the foot, getting slender at the top, measuring 29 centimeters. Weighing approximately 6.5 tons, the pillar was manufactured by forged welding and has not rusted ever since. As per the popular folklore, Delhi's Rajput king Anandpal Tomar gave his land a name based on this pillar. The story goes that King Anandpal Tomar was told by a sage that his pillar is immovable and rested on a hood of a serpent king, Vasuki. Out of sheer curiosity, Tomar decided to check the ground beneath the pillar and surprisingly, he indeed found the pillar resting on the head of a serpent king. In an awe of what he has seen, Tomar bowed to the land and ordered to install the pillar back. The pillar could be fixed back firmly and remained loose, dhila as we call it in Hindi. It was here Delhi got the first variant of his name, Dhilli, the land whose soil is loose.
Article 72 deals with power of president to grant pardons and to suspend, remit or commute sentences in certain cases. The president shall have the power to grant pardons, reprieves, respites or remissions of punishment or to suspend, remit or commute the sentence of any persons convicted of any offence. A. In all cases where the punishment of sentence is by a court-martial. B. In all cases where the punishment or sentence is for an offence against any law relating to a matter to which the executive power of the union extends. And C. In all cases where the sentence is a sentence of death.
For centuries, Delhi has been known for waterworks, given the vast number of kingdoms in the city. Among the earliest ones was a dam at Anandpur village, the city believed to be built by Rajput king Anandpal Tomar. This unique Indian hydraulic engineering structure was built around 8th century, running 50 meters long and standing 7 meters high. This dam was more of a water harvesting structure meant to store rain water during the monsoon season. Located close to Anandpur village lies Surajkund, the waterworks which is regarded as among Delhi's first organized reservoir. Built in the shape of rising sun with an eastward arc, it's enclosed with a steep embankment made in semicircular shape of stepped stones. These reservoirs took care of need of the city at the time of the shortage of water, given Delhi's topography and warm weather spells. Also, once existed a magnificent sun temple near the Surajkund reservoir.
Senior Indian Army officials on Thursday briefed envoys from Europe and Africa visiting Jammu and Kashmir about the security situation in the Union Territory. Here's more.
The envoys on a two-day visit to the valley were also briefed about the peaceful situation after the abrogation of Article 370. Decrease in incidents of stone pelting and the conduct of peaceful DDC elections in the Union Territory. The delegation was also briefed about various programs, including community engagements and counter-radicalization.
Well, some news from the Rajya Sabha now, where the nomination for Rajya Sabha by-elections for two seats of Gujarat and one seat in Assam concluded on Thursday.
BJP candidate Dinesh Anwadia and Ram Mokadia filed nominations for by-polls to two Rajya Sabha seats in Gujarat. Both are expected to be declared winners as the Congress did not field any candidate. The by-elections were necessitated due to the death of Congress veteran Ahmed Patel in November and BJP leader Abhay Bhardwaj in December last year. For the seat in Assam, the BJP has fielded Bishwajit Daimari. The nomination will be scrutinized tomorrow and voting will be held on 1st of March if necessary.
Well, staying on with the political news now, amid the turmoil in Puducherry, newly appointed Lieutenant Governor Tamilisai Soundarajan on Thursday ordered a floor test to a certain majority of the ruling Congress on February 22nd.
In an official statement, the governor noted that both ruling and opposition have strength of 14 members each in the Legislative Assembly. Voting shall take place by show of hands and the entire proceedings will be videographed. The ruling Congress currently has a strength of 10, including the Speaker, while its allied DMK has 3 members in the 33-member Assembly. Since January, 4 MLAs have resigned, 2 of whom have joined the BJP. As of now, the Congress-led alliance, including the DMK and the opposition, have 14 members each.
Union Home Minister and senior BJP leader Amit Shah has said that the TMC government does not let the central government carry out developmental works in the state. He was addressing a public meeting at Namkhana in 24 South Parganas of the state on Thursday.
Shah also reached out to the West Bengal government employees and said the 7th pay commission will be implemented in the state if the 7th party is voted to power.
Ye parivartan yatra ka panchwa charan shuru ho raha hai aur ye parivartan yatra Bengal ke har vidhan sabha kshetra ke andar jane wali hai. 294 vidhan sabha kshetra se ye parivartan rat guzarne wala hai.
Launching BJP's fifth and last phase of Parivartan Yatra, Shah said the party's aim is to ensure that there is a change for better situation in West Bengal. He had joined a refugee family for lunch at Narayanpur village and took part in a road show.
Mitro Bengal ke vikas ke liye Modi ji ne dher sare paise bheje magar ye sare paise bhet chad gaye Didi ki syndicate ke. Main aapko batana chahta hu कांग्रेस की सरकार थी तब 5 साल में कांग्रेस सरकार ने बंगाल के लिए 1,32,000 करोड़ रुपया भेजा था 1,32,000 करोड़ रुपया और नरेंद्र मोदी सरकार ने 5 साल के अंदर 3,59,000 करोड़ रुपया भेजा है 3,00,000
Some international news now, where Foreign Secretary Harshvardhan Shringla held a productive meeting with Russia's Deputy Foreign Minister Sergei Ryabkov.
Both sides exchanged views on a number of issues concerning regional and global security. Shringla also briefed his Russian counterpart about India's priorities during its BRICS chairmanship in 2021. Earlier in the day, Shringla exchanged views with leading Russian academics and strategic thinkers on the India-Russia relationship in view of the fast-changing geopolitical landscape. Shringla also paid floral tributes at the statue of Mahatma Gandhi in the premises of the Indian Embassy.
The Delhi police on Thursday told the Delhi High Court that it has not leaked any probe material to the media in connection with the FIR lodged against climate activist Disha Ravi for her alleged involvement in sharing a toolkit backing the ongoing farmers' protest.
The court was hearing a plea filed by climate activists to restrain police from leaking to the media any probe material in relation to the FIR lodged against her. The Delhi High Court also issued notice to the News Broadcasting Standards Authority and few media houses regarding publishing extracts of Ravi's private chats. The court will now hear the matter on Friday.
Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu on Thursday paid glowing tributes to former Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister late N.T. Rama Rao and said that the actor-politician was a phenomenon who strode the political stage like a colossus.
Releasing a book, Maverick Messiah, a political biography authored by senior journalist Ramesh Kandula, the vice president said, the political landscape underwent a profound change after NTR's arrival on the scene. The vice president said NTR's entry into politics and his dramatic success within about 9 months of floating a regional party gave a new direction to national politics.
Fascinating contradictions. He was a commanding personality, not demanding. But resorted to baffling theatrics and bewildering sartorial predictions. He was considered orthodox for many, but he displayed radical tendencies that caused a furor in the establishment. To outwardly religious, he was staunchly secular because he was national. I don't think secularism is the gift of any person. It is in the blood of every Indian. Though at times some people, because of political considerations, and lack of their other strengths and all, they try to use this and make secular peculiar. But the life of Indians, if you go through the thousands of years of our civilization, the values, that is unique. And N.T. Ramarao grew up to that. And some people often think secular means you should not be religious. Or you should not perform pujas and all. Puja is a way of worship. We have nothing to do with that. It's individual.
Well, with that, it's a wrap on this newscast. See you again next time.